Well, good morning, what's left of it. How are you guys doing? Enjoying the conference?
Yeah,
good stuff. I started with NDC in Oslo. Must have been the second one they ever did, maybe 10 years ago. I can't remember, but and I've followed it all around the world to different ones. And I'm really, really happy to be here today talking about Poly, which is all about handling transient errors. And, you know, what happens when the network goes down? That's the big question that Poly answers. And it's kind of easy on the client side because, you know, your network is down. That means your Wi-Fi router is out, or maybe your internet service somewhere got hosed. And you're just out of luck. You just wait, right? But if you have connected systems and microservices and architectures like this, you're not there at that point where you can do something about it. So you naturally have to have some policies in place for retrying and using some tried and true retry patterns. And that's where the word poly comes from. It's short for policies. So we're going to talk about that. I'm going to show you a bunch of different patterns. This is all using the sample code in the demos that are right on GitHub. You can go get them yourself. It's all open source, and it's very cool stuff. So let me just briefly tell you about my company, AppVNext. AppVNext is a consultancy. It started because I have this podcast that's been going on since 2002 called .NET Rocks. Anybody ever heard of that? All right, okay. That was a kind of a facetious question. So basically, I could see that, you know, when Microsoft was getting into more open source and our advertisers were dialing back on those big enterprise packages that cost thousands of dollars, and, you know, they were spending ad revenue with us, and, you know, all of a sudden, you know, C# is open source and Satya is like embracing Linux and all this stuff, and it's great for everybody. But I could see the handwriting on the wall that that revenue wouldn't last for a long time. And I really wanted to get into a consultancy. I wanted to write code and hire out guys that were really smart. So I sent out a newsletter to the .NET Rocks fan club people. And I said, hey, you know, if you're working as a professional developer and you have maybe 20 hours a week you'd like to devote to some cool projects that are coming down the pike, let me know. About 100 people wrote back, just this little paragraph in a newsletter. Out of them, I interviewed about 40 and opened up a Slack channel. And of those 40, about 10 stuck around. And those are my, like, dream team guys. And since then, we've done all these great projects. Long story short, Poly was an open source project. Michael Wolfenden was sort of wanted to pass it off to somebody who would take care of it. And we said yes. So that's how we got involved in the Poly project. In October 2016, Poly was accepted into the .NET Foundation, which is just a place that curates really good and, you know, well-beloved .NET projects. So that was kind of a coup for us. You know, transient errors are network outages, as I said before. Also service outages, things that you have no control over. Denial of service attacks, obviously. And that's an interesting one because you can actually end up causing denial of service attacks if you don't do your retry policies correctly. I/O locks and connected device failures are also in that list, but mostly it's network outages. You know, a network and service outages. Service outages happen a lot less, obviously. But what happens to get to the point of that I was making about causing a denial of service attack? What happens when you have this struggling service, like, and you just keep hammering it with retries and retries and retries, and this is kind of what happens. You probably recognize this.
Oh,
from,
this is easier. Yeah, we can handle this, okay?
Lucy. They're like Lucy and Ethel are wrapping chocolate-covered strawberries. And they just kind of start speeding up a little too fast. Struggling service is struggling even harder because
listen,
you're retrying so fast and so everybody's pinging the retry. So that's the gag of my talk. Thank you very much. So here comes Poly. So it's a .NET, you know, .NET 4.5, also standard 1.1 and standard 2.0. And standard 1.1 means it's really compatible with everything. The numbers of standard, as they go up, they get less compatible, right? Also, it's in .NET Core 2.1. It's actually in the framework. We'll talk about that in a minute. And basically, you use the Fluent syntax to create these policy objects. And these are some of the policies that you can create: a retry, a circuit breaker, a timeout, a bulkhead isolation policy. And we'll talk about all of these things. And you can just absolutely go to app, you know, github.com, app-vnax-poly. And also, poly-samples is where the sample code I'm showing you is. You'll have plenty of chances to check that out. So the resilient strategies are retry, which is, you know, maybe this is just a blip, maybe just a short outage, or maybe something happened. Maybe it's just going to resolve itself in a few seconds. We'll just retry. And the circuit breaker is the pattern that you use to avoid the Lucy Ethel situation, where that system is down, it's struggling. I'm going to stop for a while, flooding it with retries, because I want to take the pressure off of that service. If it's really struggling, I don't want to add to the problem and compound the problem. A timeout, obviously, is a good thing to have. And you can combine all these things, and I'll show you the code. Don't wait forever, as the timeout answers that. Addresses that issue. Bulkhead isolation means that if you have two services taking up competing for resources, and one is failing and the other isn't, you don't want the failing one to take down the one that isn't, you know, failing. And so we'll talk about that too. Caching is supported, and a fallback is simply substituting exception messages that are particular for that service or whatever. So if all else fails, you can, rather than just throwing a general exception or something that, you know, isn't happy, you know, your logs aren't, your people who are reading your logs aren't gonna understand, you can do something more specific. So here's the history. In 2013, Michael Wolfenden invented Poly, and in 2015, Scott Hanselman recommended it, and I did as well on .NET Rocks, and ThoughtWorks recommended it, and so we got a little blip there. And in December of that year, we took stewardship. We added full async support, and we just kept going with circuit breaker and return values, and then we added the bulkhead isolation, the fallback, all these great features, and it keeps going today. And in 2018, .NET Core 2.1 pulled in Poly to create the HTTP client factory object, so that you can, when you use the client factory instead of just an HTTP client, you can specify what the policies are that you want to use for retry. But get this, look at this, adoption. So way back in 2015, when we started talking about Poly, nobody really knew about it, and then, you know, since, it's just taken off. So we're about over 8 million cumulative packages to date. So, step one, you create a policy object, and you do that with this Fluent syntax, as I said before. And you can tell it what exceptions you want to handle specifically, or you can just say exception for everything. And yeah, you know what? This is just a wrapper around try-catch. That's really all it is. It's a wrapper around try-catch with smarts built in and with retry policies, et cetera. So this one particular is a retry forever asynchronous policy, which means that there isn't a timeout, there isn't a, well, there could be a timeout, but if you combine it with a timeout, but there isn't a number of retries to stop at. It's just gonna continue. And then step two is you execute it, and you have a lambda there that happens, you know, the thing that you want to execute goes in that lambda. And then you have these other handlers for what to do when you get when you're doing a retry. When you've caught an exception, you have a new place to log that or do whatever you want with it. So again, these are some ways that you can combine the patterns. So retry just immediately on failure, a number of retries. You have a wait and retry, so that's a retry with a timeout in between each. And you can either just keep it constant or change the timeout between each retry, like for an exponential backoff. I'll show you a demo of that too. So, you know, the first one's gonna wait 30 seconds, the next one's gonna wait 60 seconds, the next one 90 seconds, whatever. Or exponentially, you could back that off. And retry forever keeps retrying until it succeeds. And this is just the retry pattern. Like, these are all your options with retrying. And this is just, you know, we're gonna wait and see if maybe it's a blip, maybe it'll clear itself up. Give it another go. Retry forever is an interesting one. There are actually times when you need that. I remember I was building an app that was a sort of a screen by screen WPF app, and you were collecting data from a connect, actually, in one screen. And then in between screens, it would send that data up to the cloud where they would do some measurements on it and do some secret sauce, give you back numbers which you had to have in order to continue using the app. So if that didn't work, you're done, right? So client side, retry forever, no problem. I mean, obviously the user's gonna know, hey, my internet is down, go reboot the router, that's why my app is hanging. Or you could, you know, just tell them, please wait, or give them the little spinny. But again, these things on the server side, you know, in a microservices world, are become a lot more important. All right, so the circuit breaker, the ladies in the video, obviously, the downstream system are having a meltdown, so what we're gonna do is stop sending chocolates down the line for a while. So it's like stopping the conveyor belt. In other words, it fails at the caller side, to the caller, right? So instead of just retrying, which you're gonna do, but you say, you know, if that circuit is broken, don't. Just wait for 4 seconds, 5 seconds, 10 seconds before we continue retrying. However many seconds you wanna wait, you just stop. You fail right early at the caller side, so the calls don't actually go through. So the original circuit breaker was a trigger to break. The trigger to break was too many chocolates in a row get dropped. In an advanced circuit breaker, the trigger is too high of a proportion of chocolates get dropped. So you can specify which one you want to use. So the timeout, and of course we can combine these things, right? Stop waiting once you think an answer won't come. You have an optimistic mode, which gives you a cancellation token, which means that I could cancel this timeout if I wanted to. And in pessimistic, enforces the timeout even when the delegate doesn't support it. So there's just a couple of ways that you can use a timeout. Bulkhead isolation, the source of this idea is large ocean liners. You know, great big ships, they don't have one big empty hull. If they did, and they get torpedoed, or they hit an iceberg or something, you know, the whole ship will go down. Titanic, case in point. But if the hull is broken off into sections, like different rooms, you could call them, they're bulkheads. One of those bulkheads could fill with water, and it could continue on. So one problem doesn't take down the whole ship. And the related software principle is that you want to limit the resources consumable by different operations so that one faulting stream doesn't sink the whole system. I mean, in a regular generic software term, a multi-threaded application might be considered a bulkhead application. Because if you're making calls on one thread and not receiving anything, the other thread's still pumping along. So that's sort of the analogy. Another analogy is supermarkets. They reserve checkout lines for, you know, 12 items or fewer. You have the express lane. So that's really bulkhead isolation. If they didn't isolate those different streams, if it was all mixed and there was a glut of large shopping carts going through, the large carts would flood all the checkout aisles and use all the capacity. So if you're just buying eggs, you're going to wait just as long as if you're buying a whole shopping cart full of stuff. So reducing, you know, having some reserved aisles for those smaller loads is bulkhead isolation. A read through cache. So caching, obviously, we didn't just reinvent the cache, but we have ways that you can plug in your own cache, right? So easy to add any cache provider that you like, memory cache, Redis, Amazon, whatever you like. And, you know, that's because we've failed doesn't mean we should fail to the caller. You know, we may have a situation, you may have a situation where the exact URL or, you know, request was made before, that's in the cache. Rather than fail, I will just return the last one that we had. You know, you have to make that decision whether or not that would be acceptable. And fallback is a substitute value to provide or an action when an operation fails. So this is like the final try catch rather than just, you know, erroring out with whatever the exception was. You can prepare how you'll respond when a particular failure finally does occur. And then there's this cool thing in Poly called a policy wrap where you can combine any of the policies together. So you can create individual policies and you can nest them. So you might have a wait and retry policy and a circuit breaker. And the circuit breaker runs within the nest of the wait and retry. And it doesn't retry if the exception was a circuit breaker exception, right? So if the circuit is broken, it won't retry. That's kind of how you can do it. But you can also put them together in a policy wrap, and it goes outer to inner. So in this case, the fallback is the outer policy, then a retry, then a circuit breaker, and then a timeout. So easy to put them all in one policy. So the basics are you define how these exceptions should be handled. It's fluent and concise, it's thread safe, asynchronous or synchronous. You can reuse it across call sites, they're just objects. You can chain policies together. You can apply them to any action or function. So basically any code can be accessed or any code can be executed within the scope of a policy. There's a great discussion of these resilient patterns covered in Michael Nygaard's book, Release It, if you're really interested in a little bit more of how these things work. So let's get to some demos here. So there's the Poly GitHub site, and then there's a Poly sample site where you can download these samples I'm going to show you. Now I've broken them up into the web API project and the client project. In the web API project, the Poly test app, you can see that we've created this throttling handler, right? And it essentially limits the method calls. So the maximum number of allowed requests within a specified time span, and then you're going to get 500 errors. So in this case, we allow 3 calls within 5 seconds. And the 4th call within 5 seconds, we're going to turn a 500 error. All right? So this is just a way that we can set up a test, you know, mechanism to simulate failure. And in the values controller, it's very simple. You pass in a number, and we respond, response from server to request number, ID string, ID 2 string. So that's it. Just so that we know we got a request. Now the demo app runs against this, or we also have a version of it running in the cloud. And here's the demo app right here. And in the configuration, you can either use the local version or you can use our Poly test app, azurewebsites.net. So all of these demos are completely useless in terms of showing you anything that you would use in the real world. But what they do is they illustrate how to you know, handle these problems when they occur and give you all the different ways in which you can handle them, right? So the demos themselves are kind of, you know, I guess you'd call not practical. It's not like you could take this code and just, you know, plop it into your project. But after going through these progression of these demos, you'll be able to see how the different levels of being able to, of complexity of handling problems as they come up. So the very first demo, and they're all basically the same, except for the policies. So the very first demo is no policy. And they all kind of look like this. So here we have an execute async. All right, we've got little timers and all of that stuff. And we're keeping track of the total requests. And we'll do the following until a key is pressed. And we increase the total requests. And we just have a HTTP client that gets the string from the API root plus API values and the total requests. And we display with the response, right? Now we're using a try catch here. So if we have an error, which we're going to get after the three go in 5 seconds, we're gonna see in red, not green, that this failed. Then we're gonna wait a half a second and just keep trying it again. Now, after all of that happens, you get these statistics. You get to see all the numbers. So there you go. I'm going to increase the font here a little bit for y'all. Right. So I'll hit a button here. And you can see the green responses are good. The red ones, nope. We got the 503 error. OK. So the first one we're going to do is retry a number of times. Take a look at that one. So this is a retry policy, and we're defining it right here. Policy handle all exceptions, and it's a retry asynchronous policy 3 times. And then you get this little lambda here with passes in the exception and the attempt. And you can do whatever you want, like tell the user what they want. This is your new exception handler for retrying. And you say, here's the message in yellow, and we're logging this right now. So this is when we execute, right? We still have our try catch, but we're doing this await policy execute async, and all of this code right here executes within the policy. Now you can see 3 retries immediately don't really do all that much, and then we finally get that exception handler in red. Right. So these happened, you know, within the policy we defined when a retry error occurs. We got the response code does not indicate success. You've exceeded the maximum number of allowed calls. We retry again. We do that 3 times in a row with no timeout in between, and then it fails. Okay, now slightly different. We're going to wait. We're going to put a timeout in there in between each one. So here's the policy. It's a wait and retry. The retry count is still 3. And now we have our sleep duration 200 milliseconds. All right? Not very much. But you can see it's not going to go boom, boom, boom. It's going to go a little bit slower. Everything else in this demo is exactly the same. We execute with the policy, we execute the get string async. So it's, you know, a little bit better. We're waiting a little bit, but we're still having the same problem. And this is why I say, you know, this isn't prescriptive. We're just showing you how these different things behave. All right. The next one. Now we've added enough retries. We put in some magic numbers here. Instead of 3 retries, we're going to do 20 retries. Okay? Again, not prescriptive. Just let's see what happens when we actually have enough retries to cover the error. So now we never get that exception being thrown, but we're still hammering it with retries every 200 milliseconds. Follow me so far? I'll take that as a yes. Okay. So now we have a wait and retry forever. And it's a different policy, but the effect is going to be exactly the same. So now we're not specifying a number of retries, and we're also still at 200 milliseconds, but now the policy is wait and retry forever async. Everything else exactly the same. Okay, so we got rid of the magic numbers on that one. Now we're going to use an exponential backoff. And the way we can do that is we change the timeout every time we fail, right? Every time we get, every time we have a problem, we get that error. We're going to change right here the backoff to an exponential number. So it's going to start with 2 seconds, 4 seconds, 8 seconds, 16 seconds, etc. Just a little bit of maths. Right? That's a little bit smarter. Yep. Okay. Now we're going to start nesting multiple policies. And this is a wait and retry that has a circuit breaker inside of it. And again, the circuit breaker is, the analogy of a circuit breaker might be a little strange because we use open and close to describe a circuit. And if you're coming from the database world, database connections are open when you're using them and closed when they're not available, right? But a circuit isn't that way. A circuit is closed, allowing electricity to flow through it. So that's when it works. When it's open, it's broken, right? So when a circuit is open, it is not working. So we're going to break the circuit if we decide that the downstream system has needs some cool-off time instead of continuously sending retries, right? So we have two policies. Here's the wait and retry policy. Again, 200 milliseconds, and it's a wait and retry forever. But look at this. We can filter the exception here. We can not just we can handle all exceptions where the exception is not a broken circuit exception. So as the comment says, if we don't retry if the inner circuit breaker judges the underlying system is out of commission. So there's the wait and retry policy. And then the circuit breaker policy allows 4 exceptions before breaking the circuit, and then breaks the circuit for 3 seconds. And we're going to show this in magenta. All right, so everything in the circuit breaker is in magenta. Everything in the wait and retry is in yellow. And then you nest them simply by calling one within the other. So the outer policy is the wait and retry policy. And then we execute the circuit breaker policy, execute within that. All right, so this is nesting. And then the code within the inner policy. All right, so let's just look at that for a second. Let's go back to the top. First 3 come through, no problem. All right, then the wait and retry, right? Three times, 200 milliseconds. The circuit breaker then breaks the circuit, and it says, because four retries, this is actually the fourth retry, you know, because it's asynchronous, it comes out of order. But then the circuit breaker breaks it for 3 seconds because four exceptions have happened. And then we're failing immediately to the caller, broken circuit exception, right? Our exception, you cannot call right now, right? Yeah, I know you're sending retries and all that stuff, but we're telling you that we're not putting it through. We're stopping the conveyor belt of chocolates, all right, for a few seconds. And then when the circuit is ready to test, if we're ready to test it to see if it's working again, it's called half open. So the next call is a trial, and then that went okay, so we closed the circuit again, and we're back to good stuff. All right, so nesting is probably not a good idea, but it's there to show you how these things work together. But now that we know that, we're going to use a policy wrap instead of nesting these two things. And this works exactly the same way. So here's our wait and retry policy, exactly the same as before. Here's our circuit breaker policy, exactly the same as before. But instead of nesting them, we're using a policy wrap. Here's the outer policy first and the inner policy second. And then we just execute within the policy wrap. Now we don't have to nest anything. Exactly the same demo with exactly the same output consequence, except that it's a lot easier to manage, a lot easier to code. Okay. So now we're going to complexify this a little bit more. We're going to wrap a fallback with a wait and retry and a circuit breaker. And the fallback, as I said before, is a general fallback per policy. So in other words, depending on what the final exception was, you can return a different message, a substitute message. And we actually have two fallbacks here. Here's our wait and retry policy, exactly the same. Wait and retry forever, 200 milliseconds. Our circuit breaker policy, exactly the same as well. Four exceptions before breaking, break for 3 seconds. Now we have a fallback policy for the broken circuit exception. Just for the broken circuit exception. So this is a fallback for circuit breaker is the name of it. And we're going to say fallback catches failed with the message, yada yada, that's in red. And now we also have a fallback for any exception. So this handles exception. And that's going to be the outermost policy. So check this out. So the first resilience strategy wraps wait and retry and circuit breaker. So that's our basic retries and, you know, our resilience policies. And then we wrap those in fallback for any exception, wrapping fallback for circuit breaker, wrapping the resilience strategy. So we have fallback for any exception, and then inside that we fall back for the circuit breaker, then we have the wait and retry, and then finally the circuit breaker inside. So there's four policies all together in one, and we wrap that, and here's the execute async. We do our code again. The code itself is a lot cleaner. Everything's handled by the policies. Okay, so take a look here. We have our three good calls. Our wait and retry policy gets to four. The circuit breaker breaks the circuit for 3 seconds, right? And then the fallback, rather than just being a regular exception, the fallback catches this with the circuit is now open and not allowing any calls, right? So that's what we're actually failing use with, and the response is please try again later. And then finally the you know, the trial goes through and it's okay and we're back off to the races. And now this one is without a circuit breaker. This is wrapping a fallback and a timeout wait and retry. So here's our timeout. And the reason we're doing this is to show that the timeout policy can, you know, return. The timeout policy can kick in after a certain amount of time, no matter what's going on underneath, right? So if you have these wait and retry and circuit breakers and all of these things going on, at a certain point, if you want to say, look, let's keep this up for like 10 minutes, and then, hey, this is hopeless. This isn't going to work right now. Do something else. So the timeout policy, we specifically set it short, 2 seconds. All right? It's pessimistic, meaning that no matter what's going on underneath, we're going to, 2 seconds is an absolute. If we can't resolve this in 2 seconds, we'll fail with a timeout. And then we have a wait and retry policy set higher than that, 4 seconds. So the purpose of that is to make sure the timeout gets triggered, right? That's the only reason that we're setting the timeout lower than the wait time in between the wait and retry. And now we have a fallback for the timeout exception. And now we have a fallback for any exception. And we're going to wrap these. First, the fallback for any exception, then the fallback for timeout, then the timeout policy, then the wait and retry policy. And you can see the fluent syntax here. Fallback for any exception dot wrap async paren fallback for timeout dot wrap async paren timeout policy dot wrap async paren wait and retry policy. It's pretty elegant. And then, of course, the code is exactly the same. We have our policy wrap. We execute the get string async, and we'll see what happens. All right, remember that was 3 seconds, but then the 2 second timeout kicked in, and we return this in red. The fallback catches failed with the delegate executed asynchronously through timeout policy did not complete within the timeout. All right, the bulkhead demos, these are cool. So remember I was talking about how ocean liners, the hull is separated into bulkheads so that one, you know, a torpedo that goes through one hull, piece of the hull doesn't sink the whole ship. And that's exactly what's happening here. We have a bulkhead policy. And I'm going to show two demos, one with no isolation and then one with isolation, and you can see the difference. So I'm just going to read the comments here because Dylan did a great job of commenting these. So imagine a microservice or web front end, the upstream caller, trying to call two endpoints in a downstream system, right? So one microservice is trying to call two downstream systems. The good endpoint responds quickly. The faulting endpoint faults and responds really slowly. So the caller has limited capacity because all of the single instances of upstream services eventually hit some limit. So this demo doesn't separate the call streams into separate bulkheads. So randomly we pick which one we're going to call, the good one or the bad one. And you can observe because the bulkheads don't isolate the separate streams of calls, eventually all the caller's capacity is taking up waiting on the faulting downstream calls. So the performance of the good calls is starved of the resource and starts suffering too. So watch the number of pending and failing calls to the good endpoint also climbing as the faulting calls saturate all the resources in the caller. And, you know, the code isn't something that we're going to walk through line by line, but just suffice it to say that there's this inside of our, we randomly make either a good or a faulting call, and we have two endpoints on the API. One is a slash API not throttled good, and the other is a API non-throttled faulting, all right? So it's essentially, an if-then. If we're calling the good request, we do it this way. If we're calling the bad one, we do it this way. And then we get to see the statistics of how they get called. So I'll just let this run for a few seconds. And you can see, at first, we got some in green, and now we're just getting more red. We're getting more failures. So good endpoints requested were 26 of those. 10 succeeded, 1 was pending, and 15 failed. So that was the good endpoint. We got failures on them. The faulting endpoint, 28 were requested, 0 succeeded, there's 9 pending, and 19 failed. So there you go. That's something that we do not want to see. Now, when we use the bulkheads, okay. We have two bulkhead policies. One is bulkhead for good calls, and then we have one for faulting calls. And those policies basically allow us to use, the policy within. We're executing that same code, to call the non-throttled good or the non-throttled faulting calls. Let this go for a bit. Now you can see a lot more green happening here now. And we're still getting faulting calls. Let's just stop that there. All right, so the good endpoints, requested 30, 29 succeeded, only 1 is pending because we stopped it. The faulting, 38, 0 succeeded, 14 pending, 24 failed. So there you go. All right, so getting back to the slide deck here. This is just a tip. If you're running the demos, you want to uncheck the tick box if you're demoing the samples out of Visual Studio. Otherwise, it's gonna stop on you. All right, so further features. So you can handle multiple exception types in one policy with a filter, which is what we did when we were in the wait and retry policy. We were filtering all exceptions except for if we had an open circuit, right? So here's one where you can handle a SQL exception where the number is 1205, right? You can be very specific in the exceptions you want to handle per policy. So that's pretty cool. You can handle both exceptions and return values from within the same policy. And this is important because SOAP services, for example, will always return a 200, even if they failed. Because as far as SOAP is concerned, hey, everything's cool. But you have to dig down into the return value in the XML to find out what actually happened. So now you can look at that return value as well. You can handle inner exceptions, dot or inner. So policy.handle HTTP request exception, dot or inner operation canceled exception. So you can be, again, more specific as to how to handle particular problems. There's a simple key value store called policy registry. So in a dynamic reconfiguration scenario, in some applications it might be useful to be able to reconfigure policies dynamically without restarting the process. So for example, you might want to tweak circuit breaking thresholds to be more or less sensitive according to conditions in production. So with this policy registry, you just replace the policy in the registry with a new one, and when the underlying configuration source is detected to have changed, there's stuff on the wiki about that if you're interested in it. Integration with .NET Core at 2.1. So HTTP client factory. So this is a fluent syntax for configuring HTTP client instances with poly policies governing calls. Also, it's cool because it provides a central location for naming and configuring local HTTP clients. So you might configure a client that is pre-configured to access the GitHub API, for example. And it manages the lifecycle of HTTP client instances and deals with earlier confusion about how frequently to recycle or dispose HTTP client instances, DNS changes, and all that stuff. Our wiki has full documentation, as does the .NET Core docs itself. So we got some new stuff coming up. Fake failures for tests. So great unit testing when you want to test a failure and see how well your policy code handles it. You can actually inject results into that and pass the failure policy into your component. Pretty cool. Also, chaos engineering. There's actually a new project, and it just came out. Let me see if I can show it to you without, I think I have to close this. Let me see. Yeah. So we have Simi. So at poly-contrib, which is sort of a place where you can contribute things to Poly, right? And so Simi is this chaos engineering and fault injection tool integrating with Poly. And that's exactly what it's for. It injects faults. And you know, like the chaos monkey at Netflix, this is the kind of stuff you can do. And I haven't played with it, so I can't demo it, but I can just tell you that you can go get the demos and try it out yourself. You can inject a fault, you can inject latency or behavior, and here's some good examples of that. That's all new stuff. Yeah, so this is about latency and lots of configuration there. So down the road this year, we're looking at telemetry, like emitting circuit health, call duration, real-time monitoring, that kind of stuff. And also a distributed circuit breaker, because serverless and actor models inherently short-lived, so they can't really maintain any kind of circuit statistics. How many calls have failed lately internally, so they often exist in multiple instances horizontally scaled, you know? So they need to store and track the circuit state externally, and that's what the distributed circuit breaker is gonna do. It's gonna help with that. Now, there are some other projects that do what Poly does in different languages. JavaScript, there's poly-js, and this is cool, based on Poly. .NET, it's a small subset of capability through retry and retry wait policies. And in the Java world, Hystrix is the robust resilience framework by Netflix, but it's no longer in development as of early 2018 when Netflix decided to end active development. And the original engineers moved on, and hopefully this will be taken up by other contributors. So here's an example of the JavaScript. Poly.js looks pretty similar, right? And this may not be the final syntax. There's some details on the Poly website. And here's the Hystrix sample for the Java heads out there. So here's the wiki. It's a really good place to check out and see what we're doing. There's some extended documentation and patterns and unit test things up there. More details that aren't in the regular Poly documentation are on the wiki. And that's github.com/app-vnext/poly/wiki. And there's also a Slack channel, polytalk.org. Great to get in there and talk to the people who are working on it, and the polyproject.org is our blog, so that we have all the announcements and things on the blog, just in case you didn't have enough to do. So here are all the people who are involved. Mostly all I do is talk to people like you about Poly. I'm just an evangelist to tell everybody that it's up there, that it's free. Go get it, use it, it's good. Dylan Reisenberger came on when we took on AppVNext. I'm sorry, when AppVNext took on Poly, he and Joel really did the majority of the work. I actually wrote the first client demo, and Joel wrote the throttling handler, and then Dylan just sort of took it over from there. He's a .NET Enterprise architect, microservices cloud guy, and Joel Hewlin is also an enterprise cloud guru. And if anybody else wants to jump on and help and contribute, there you go. Also look at the Poly Contrib group, which I mentioned before. So we're out 10 minutes early. Thanks very much. If you have any questions, I'll just be down on the side. Okay? Thanks.